man. How's everybody doing? Robbie, it's been forever. I haven't seen you in forever. I'm getting an echo. Do one of you guys have the stream playing in the background?
I don't.
No?
No? Make sure it's not me.
It's most certainly not me.
All right, yeah, so Beastly Thoughts Live, what's going on, guys? We got Robbie back. We got Beastly Gamer here. I'm Briar Rabbit. We're going to get this done. We're going to get this done this week. We got news.
Damn.
We got reviews. We got shit talking. I mean, we got it all. One spot. One spot. Your weekly place. Your one-stop location for the latest in video game news, reviews, and shit talking. We got all three.
Hell yes.
All three.
Yes. West side, motherfucker.
All right, Robbie. Side. So you have been gone. This is you. 2 weeks you were gone. I want to hear what you've been up to, man. What you've been playing? What you've been up to?
He's been working at that strip club, right? Are you the doorman, or how does that work? You've been doing security. Do you ever look at the strippers, or do you still like look at the ground when they approach you? How does it work?
Well, you know, I try and get below them when I can. Anyways, guys, I've been playing Uncharted 4 this week, and I've been playing Doom. Been loving both of those. Let's get all out of the stripper talk, get straight to video games, because I have been playing some awesome video games this week. I mean, Uncharted 4, I'm sure you guys have gone over. It is an amazing game. Like, it's an outstandingly good video game, and I think Naughty Dog has done an amazing job with this game. Everything from visually, the storytelling, just narrative, gameplay, everything is excellent. The multiplayer is fun. I mean, this is another awesome, excellent game from them. And Doom is awesome too. Yeah! Doom
is yes, it is. So good.
Yeah. Doom is everything I wanted it to be. I never suspected it would be, but it is so good. It's remember how we were all excited about, or we were all surprised by the latest Castle Wolfenstein game?
Yes.
This is like double that surprise for me. Like I mean, the fact that they didn't send out reviewer copies, the fact that there's basically zero hype going into Doom. They came out with that multiplayer beta, which I liked, but, you know, didn't really generate a lot of buzz in the community. Man, this game is fucking good.
Yes. Really good.
Oh, God. Yes, it is, man. That's the game I've been playing for the last 2 days. I started on it yesterday. I bought it Friday, and I actually started yesterday. And I probably put in a good 8 or 9 hours so far. And dare I say, this might be the best first-person shooter I've played in the last few years. The way it feels... The only way that I can truly describe it that gives it the credit that it's due is I feel like I'm playing a PC game on a PS4, the way that the game moves. You guys know how it is when you're watching the PC gameplay of a first-person shooter, the way that it moves so smooth and seamlessly.
At 60 frames per second?
This game, it just translates the same way to me. I feel like I'm playing a PC game somehow on my PS4. It has some of the best visuals I've seen in a first-person shooter. The animations are insane. The story is Doom. They've really gone back and taken all the great aspects that we used to love about the old Doom. I actually showed my daughter today. She said, Dad, what did Doom used to look like? And so I put Doom on PlayStation 1.
You see it right in this game.
Yeah.
There's an Easter egg.
No, I haven't seen the Easter egg. I figured there would be one, but I haven't seen it. I haven't watched any guides or anything, so I probably screwed that up because I just got the BFG 9000, so more than likely I completely missed it. But I showed her that, and she was like, oh, wow, I remember you played this game. It looks so different. But every aspect of that game that made it great, how fast, how fluid it was, it all translates really well into this game. But the fact that they've also included a very digestible story that's also entertaining.
The story, the humor, the interactions your character has with, like, the nutty professor there. Like, the way he's just kind of exasperated with you. Like, you never do anything that, like, fucking Doom Dude wouldn't do, right? He's just like this,
They figured out a way to make this work,
right? It's like they didn't go over the top like something like, I'm trying to think like Battleborn what's their previous games? The Battleborn devs.
Borderlands.
Yeah, they didn't go over the top with like the ridiculousness. This game is ridiculous. The characters are ridiculous, but they embrace it and they. they use it in such a good manner that it's just fun to be a part of it. You want to see what's going to happen next, even though this guy is just basically this like nameless fucking Marine like that he's always been, right?
I love it too.
Yeah, it's amazing how they did that.
Well, I really like the way that they've made this Marine's personality shine through without him saying anything, because you can easily go into a first-person shooter, destroy thousands of enemies, and you won't know much about this person's temperament.
Yeah.
This guy is agitated. He doesn't touch anything softly. And basically, if you tell him, throughout the story arc, there's been times where you've been told to do certain things and to be as delicate as possible. This guy will go in there and kick the shit out of stuff, break everything he can.
Smash computers.
There was a portion of the game where I had to use a person's hand to get through a doorway. And so, of course, it was a limb on the ground. He just slams the limb up against it, and he did the same thing with the guy's head.
Yeah.
I love
just
that.
Just slammed the guy's head in there. I was like, oh, this guy is just very, very... The violence of this game is really portrayed well with the character.
Yeah.
And
graphically, it looks stunning too. It's running at a buttery smooth 60 frames per second. On the PS4, I don't think it drops off of 1080p. If it does, I haven't seen it. I mean, it looks insane. All right, so here's the deal, right? We just saw Uncharted. We got Doom out now. I mean, there's all these games coming out right now. Like, what the fuck do I want a PS4.5K for? Like, these games look extraordinary. Why do I want to go out and spend another $400? You know, like, what am I getting? Like, these games, we're just getting the games that feel like they're really running. They're really optimized for the PS4, for the Xbox. Man, like, do I really want to buy into another generation? Like, another hardware bump? Well, and have to wait another 2 or 3 years for them to figure out how to write games for that?
Optimize that? Yeah. Well, I guess if... Once these things actually become available, they're going to have to really convince the gamers that they're needed. But let's take a little bit of time to talk about some of these games. We've kind of touched bases a little bit on Doom, and I think from all accounts, it's an incredible game. For me, it's one of my favorite first-person shooters now. It's so fast. It's extremely violent. These fatality moves that you do on these demons in hell are some of the most gory and satisfying moves I've seen in any first-person shooter in a very, very long time. The fact that you always feel like you're running, gunning, and killing without ever slowing down really makes this game kind of stand on the top of a hill of other first-person shooters to me. Because when you compare the contemporaries to what Doom is right now, everything seems like it's in slow motion. Everything seems like it doesn't look quite as good as what Doom is. And of course, this is one of the later games for the current gen. To me, it just stands, it's something a little bit different.
So I don't want every game to be like Doom, right? I do want some variety in shooters. I think it's funny that they've kind of brought back this old school version of first person shooters, and it's eminently playable. I don't know how long it's going to be playable. I'm not going to be playing this game in a month. I'm telling you that right now. There's no way. Mm-hmm. I'm going to burn through the storyline. I'll play a little bit of multiplayer, and then I'll get back to, you know, some more, frankly, deeper games. The way you can build levels in this, I think, is pretty cool. I haven't tried that out yet, so I don't really know a whole lot about it, but that could add some replayability to it. The thing is, right, is that they have set a technological bar here, and that's really, yes. You know, they made a fun game out of it, but they set the bar very high technologically. You know, and Bethesda does sell that engine, so hopefully people will be buying, because it runs very well on a lot of everything. You know, like it's running great on Xbox One, it's running great on PS4, it's running great on PC. Boom, sell it, like make more games with this engine, because it just, the way it downscales the resolution to keep the frame rate up, that's something that can be used in all games. Overwatch is doing the same thing, that game looks beautiful. You know, like, let's do it. I'm ready for 60 frames per second games. Like, every game needs to be 60
frames. It takes six for every game. Like, it's awesome.
I got to say, Briar Rabbit, I 100% agree with what you just said. They did set a bar, a new tech bar, that other developers need to shoot for. And I didn't know they were selling this engine for other developers to use. And that's really a good sign. But the bar I feel that we haven't spoke about yet, that has truly been set and has yet to be met, is Uncharted 4. I spent 17 hours playing Uncharted 4. I beat the game 2 days ago. I did my review yesterday, which is up on the Beastly Gamer channel, by the way. And at the end of this game, I kind of sat back in my couch and I took a deep breath and kind of breathed in the experience I just had. Very seldom do you have this kind of experience. This is the kind of experience for me that I had playing like Mario 64. It's very familiar to, you know, Uncharted fans, but it's extremely different in the presentation and the way that the story is being told. Now, I'm not going to spoil anything, but there are actually four different stories being told through the Uncharted 4 A Thief's End campaign. And they all intertwine, and they are all self-contained at the same time. The way the game looks, honestly, guys, I've never seen a game that looks better than Uncharted 4 in my life. And it's hard for me to say that, right? Because I remember looking at the Order 1886, but I actually did a side-by-side comparison of the two. And the fact that this game, all the cutscenes, all the story arc sections are done with actual in-game character models. It's not a pre-rendered scene. These are the actual models doing what they're supposed to do in real time. It blew my mind, the small intricacies that Naughty Dog was able to convey in this game as far as foliage, as far as atmosphere, going out into the jungle, the water, the reflections. You know, I was Nathan. I walked into his bathroom at the beginning of the game, looked in the mirror, and he brushed his hair and kind of was messing with himself in the mirror make sure he looked good. He did a couple of things, and I've stayed there and messed around.
I remember playing the very first Uncharted, and he kind of like went through this little, it's just a little cut in the rock, and he kind of like just went to the side and kind of touched the rock as he moved through. I was like, holy shit. I think insane. Everybody in the gaming industry saw that and said, wow. And now they tripled down on that, right? They're like, everybody likes this, you know, like these context sensitive reactions. You might only see it once in the game. You might never see it if you don't do this specific thing the specific way. But they just went all out on that, and it looks cool. It adds to the immersion in a very big way.
See, we've connected in so many ways. You got the same anniversary, and we have the same memory of Uncharted 1. I swear, I remember that little scene where he grabbed the rocks. I was like, this is nuts. I can't believe they did that.
It was cool.
There was also another scene in Uncharted 4, and of course, I will not spoil anything for the people who haven't played the game. Please, please go buy the game. You deserve it. You've been good this year. You've been good to your parents. You've been good to your children. You deserve this game. But there was a scene where Nathan was talking to Elena, and I'm sure you guys have seen films where an actor will kind of accidentally look at the camera.
Yep.
Nathan did that. He looked at the camera. He was looking out of the TV at us just for that brief moment that an actor would, like where it's kind of like a mistake. He was talking to her, and he kind of turned and looked at the camera. And I got this scene saved. I was like, this is unreal that they were able to convey that level of detail in these cutscenes to make it seem that much more real. Now, the thing that kind of blew my mind, I had family game night yesterday. My dad, 61 years old, came over here last night. His wife, they hung out. My brothers and sisters came. And before we got to the family game night, I showed him some scenes from Uncharted 4. And he was telling me he remembers years ago when we were playing like Mortal Kombat, and he thought that Mortal Kombat 2 was as real as it would get.
Yeah.
And his jaw dropped. He couldn't believe it. I was just walking around. He said, Brett, I mean, he said, Beastly. He said, son, I can't believe that the graphics have come this far. Of course, my dad, he's not a gamer. He has no clue, you know, what's going on.
He hasn't been watching the progression.
No. Yeah. And so for him, that was where it all ended. You know, once he grew up and moved out, he hadn't seen anything since. And he said, this looks like a real movie. I cannot believe it. I walked down the stairs inside Nathan's house, and my dad was like, how are they doing this? How did they do that? How are they making it like a real house? I said, Dad, it's just the technology has really come
this
far.
Naughty Dog. That's all
Naughty Dog has, they've set a whole new bar. The same way they did with The Last of Us, that bar has been set and met again. They met their old bar, surpassed that, and I think this is something for other developers. This is one thing I said in my review. This is a pure sign that Naughty Dog is the only developer that's able to consistently dig down deep in these consoles and pull this magic out. There are a handful of developers who can do this consistently. Rockstar is one, of course. But the only other one that I could say does it on a consistent basis where they dig down deep into a console's hardware and pull something magical out is Naughty Dog, because they're able to do it with the graphics. They're able to tell an incredible story, and it all comes together in this limit-shattering way.
The game looks great. It plays great. It doesn't play as great as I'd like it to. It is an improvement, I think, over past Uncharted games. And the story is just fun. You know, I think it at the end there, it does suffer from, let's wrap it up here, B, but like it is a fun story.
I the way that they ended it, of course, I didn't know what was going to happen until the credits actually rolled, but the way that they ended it, I felt it was perfect. I felt it was perfect. Though I'm not going to ever say anything. I felt it was a really good ending. I know it's going to split hairs with a lot of old school gamers, old school Uncharted fans, but the way that they ended it to me was perfect. It kind of solidified everything that's happened throughout this anthology.
I was really happy. Happy he chose the yellow Corvette because I couldn't see him in the black Camaro.
I thought he was
going to
get the green one, man.
Yeah. I couldn't see him in the black Camaro. Green one.
I mean, the green one had a pink fucking stripe on the side. Come on,
that's that. That's pretty hot.
Depending on what city you're in. All right. Jeez. All right. So, Briar, what have you been playing this week?
Man, I've actually been deep diving back into Destiny. You know, it's funny too because I made a video. I think it was like Thursday or Friday. No, it was Wednesday.
All right, Robbie, I know.
I think it was like Wednesday or Thursday. I'm like, I made a video where. Man, there's just not a whole lot to talk about Destiny. Overwatch is coming out next week, so you know, I was just kind of preparing subscribers. Hey, there's going to be a little more Overwatch content on this channel because it's a game I'm really into. There's not a whole lot of news in Destiny right now, so there's not a whole lot to talk about. Probably around E3, I'll be talking more about Destiny. Then this one little fucking image gets released, right?
Internet goes nuts.
Yeah, some dude who works at a print shop. You know, took a picture of a promotional poster for Destiny's next expansion and just, like, basically reignited my interest in Destiny, like, with one little Snapchat picture.
I didn't see this. What was the
details? It's called Rise of Iron, and it shows one of the characters, Lord Saladin, on the cover with a break in the Cosmodrome wall. He's got wolves around him. It's a cross between promotional image and like one of those t-shirts that you see at like stoner shops with like the wolf like howling at the moon and like there's a unicorn behind him and like there's like a oasis, you know, the ones like big printed up.
Okay.
I don't know, it's a really good image. It got me really excited. It kind of like just reignited everything about Destiny for me. I'm still super excited about Overwatch. I plan on doing a ton of Overwatch over the next
it's out tomorrow?
All summer, frankly. Yeah, it's basically out tomorrow.
Yeah.
So that's going to be, I think, my summer game. But man, it was funny. It was so funny because like I'm just kind of like, all right, there's not a whole lot going on in Destiny right now. Like I think I'm going to just kind of move along here. Oh wait! Holy shit!
Yeah.
So yeah, it's been Destiny.
Before we get on with the show, we do got a little bit of news. I want to let you guys know if you have a PlayStation, PlayStation 4, PlayStation 3, or Vita, there's a $5 PlayStation flash sale going on right now. And I went in there and I spent $20 yesterday. There's a nice little selection. Some of these games are $30 and $40. And you could actually catch some of these deals. Some of them are older games like Killzone Shadowfall, but getting that for $5 is Terraria, games like that. I got the gamer pack, you know, for family game night and stuff, so I bought three of those too. But there's a lot of really cool games if you got the extra bucks in your PayPal, or maybe you could do some dishes and ask your mom and dad to front you the money. It's a good time to catch those sales, and I just want to let you guys know.
That's awesome. Thank you for letting everybody know about that. That's
Cool. I think the sale's over tomorrow, so I think anybody who watches the show today will definitely have a chance to catch it.
Cool.
They just randomly come up too, like they don't necessarily even announce it. So they're like, oh, flash sale. Yeah.
I like that. And see, the good thing about my life is because I was playing Doom, and then the lady in my life said, "Hey, babe, there's a flash sale going on right now." And I was like, "Really?" That happens to me all the time. I feel so lucky. Or my wife will text me at work and tell me some fucking gaming news. I'm like, I got the best life and the best wife.
That's unbelievable.
You guys may notice today's show is a little bit more structured than last week. We did get a lot of great reception from you guys on the witty banter back and forth from Mr. Briar Rabbit and myself. And it was all scripted. No, I'm just kidding.
I'm still mad about that, man. Still mad about what you said.
Damn it.
What did you say?
I can't even repeat it. Can't even repeat it.
Don't tell everybody, Brett. This week, we're back to our old structured, boring way because Mr. Robbie is back with our news.
I brought the boredom.
Yes.
You guys are welcome.
Back with a little bit of news for you guys. And since Robbie hasn't been here for 2 weeks, he's going to read all the news. Go ahead and get started, Robbie. I'm not reading shit.
You guys, well, okay. Wow.
I think he's mad that you're back, Robbie. I think you're stealing his limelight and he's pissed off about it.
I'll just sit. I don't even feel
welcome. Nice, I don't feel welcome here.
I might as well just leave.
We don't take kindly to your kind around here.
What kind is he? Canadian. Oh, he's Canadian. I always forget. Who doesn't take kindly to Canadians? Like, is that a thing?
You got to be real fucked up to do that. Saddam Hussein just gave Robbie a hug. Yeah? You guys are the nicest people, honestly. So, starting off the news, I want to take it back right now. People Can Fly, the developer behind Bulletstorm, which is actually a really good game, and the Gears of War Judgment game, is working on a brand new AAA shooter. What are the details of this news, Mr. Robbie? Is that all?
Yeah, they just started development around earlier this year. They said it won't be announced probably until next year, but whatever this is, like, I'm very excited because Bulletstorm, very underrated game. I really liked it. Gears of War Judgment was also very good, so whatever this is, count me in. Like, I can't wait to see what this is.
Yeah. Wouldn't it be safe that Gears of War Judgment would be considered the Arkham... what was the third Arkham game?
Origins.
Wouldn't that be considered the Arkham Origins of the Gears of War anthology?
Yeah, it kind of is.
You mean it's bad?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. It's not,
to be honest, Arkham Origins isn't bad. You know, it's another game that Rocksteady could have actually made. But yeah. Everyone knew that they didn't, so it immediately gave it a stigma. And people were looking for...
I think PC users would say it was bad.
No, that's Arkham Knight. That's Arkham Knight.
Oh, okay. My bad.
Arkham Knight. PC.
That's Rocksteady. But Arkham Origins was, to me, was just as good as the other Arkham games. It had slight changes, and some things weren't changed enough, and a lot of people had problems with that. So, yeah, I'm looking forward to that. I also agree. I think Bulletstorm is a really fun game and definitely underrated. Definitely. Sony has confirmed its E3 2016 press conference will be held on June 14th at 6 p.m. Pacific.
Not long till E3 now.
I gotta see how many close. Vacation days I got left. Because I don't want to fucking be at work during E3.
Me too. I should check with my boss.
You guys better phone in sick, yeah, ahead of time.
Oh, yeah, I can take it off.
Oh, that was awesome. His boss is right there in the same room with him.
Motherfucker, he's right here. He follows me home. It's awful.
Yeah, I saw you. Can I? Okay. All right, good. EA confirmed that Star Wars Battlefront originally included a single-player campaign. It was later cut so the game could be released in time for the theatrical release of The Force Awakens. I did a story on
Boom.
This, too.
That stings.
You should have done that in your Darth Vader voice.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Boom, motherfucker.
That's right.
There you go.
You know, it's one of those situations, of course, now Battlefront, the new Battlefront's actually in development now. I think they're talking about...
Oh, they're making another one already?
Yeah.
So they can put all that single-player assets they developed for the first one and the second one, call it a new game?
Yeah, but they're going to put a campaign in this one, which will make some people happy. There's also two Star Wars games simultaneously being developed as well, one being helmed by Amy Hennig of Uncharted fame. Yeah. So that's the one I'm the most excited about right now. Game.
That's going to be amazing, whatever that is. They're a fucking good studio. Like, damn, I love Dead Space.
I want to see who Amy Hennig crafts this story around. She has a thing for making very likable characters, and also some really unlikable ones. So I'm really interested. That's probably the Star Wars game that's piqued my interest the highest at this point.
Yeah, and I mean, you know, we can all realize why EA did this. Obviously, it's because to write off the movie, right? Like, it probably helped the game out a lot, but it still sucks. It still stings that they were in development of a campaign and they cut it out because they had to release it along the movie. That still kind of burns me a bit, but I still really like the game. I think the multiplayer was very fun. I didn't play it for months and months, but I enjoyed it, so I was still happy with it.
I got the game... And I don't think I've had but maybe one or two multiplayer matches. I really enjoy it, but I've got so much other crap. I've got Rainbow Six, and I still haven't even loaded it. You know.
I mean, this is an awesome, like, $30 game. It's perfect for that. But $60, it's pushing it.
Yeah, well, sometimes it's like that, man. If you got the money, sometimes you make bad choices. It's called a bad investment. You know, we got all these bad investments going on right now, like Hillary Clinton. All right, so continuing on. Call of Duty Black Ops 1 is now backwards compatible on the Xbox One. This is...
I can't believe you just said Beastly.
the thoughts reflected by the Beastly Gamer are not reflective of the Beastly Thoughts crew. Thank you. Disclaimer. All right, so Call of Duty Black Ops 1 has been made backwards compatible on the Xbox One, and the sales for Black Ops 1 on the Xbox 360 have gone up 13,000% on Amazon. So it said a 13,000% spike in sale because people want to play a Call of Duty that they know is actually good. And so now with this new network, people are really enjoying the old Call of Duty without all the hackery. And I think if they did this for all the Call of Duties on the Xbox One, that would bring so many people back to the Xbox One because of the dream, Briar. I know that part of you still has a dream, like Martin Luther King, that you can play any Call of Duty game without any motherfucking hackers on your Xbox One.
Yes. That's right. That's right. Hell, I'm going to do this. I still have my copy of Black Ops 1, and I love that game. Oh, I think it's in my top three favorite Call of Duties, or frankly, shooters of all time. I love that game. You know, the shooting mechanics were super fun. I love that, like, 1970s and 80s, like, the guns they were using. It was just, like, this old retro style. It was just cool, man. It was a cool game. I'm going to go back and play it. I'm going to do this.
See, I bought that on PlayStation 3, and this was probably a year and a half ago where I actually bought that.
That was a mistake.
And, yeah, well, tell me now, right? And so I ordered it on eBay.
Then, too. It's always been inferior on PlayStation.
Yeah, come on, man.
It's true.
Come on. Give me some slack.
There were ports on the PlayStation back in those days, and they were not as good.
Yeah, see, I didn't know that. You know, my wife had the Xbox 360.
I would have told you.
I didn't start believing you until 2015, Brian.
You still don't believe me.
You're right. All right, so I ordered this Thursday on Xbox 360, and it'll be coming from eBay in a couple of days. I've been, you know, reading a lot of articles, and everybody's really excited about just playing this game the way it was intended to be played all those years ago, where skill actually matters again. Yep. And I think that Sony should try to find a way to do that, because if they don't, Xbox is going to pull a lot of business towards that Xbox One, and people can just... Like me, I'm really enjoying that Xbox One backwards compatibility right now. It's free, and there's a ton of good games right now that I can play on my Xbox One that I can't enjoy on the PS4. And that just gives that console a lot
more
value.
Maybe with the 4.5 or the PS4K, they'll be able to do that. They'll have a little extra power to do some emulation in there.
Well, I don't know, man. Whether or not they're able to do emulation, I think that's kind of a moot point because Sony is charging for their shit. I mean, they're charging for PlayStation Now. They're charging for the PlayStation 2 emulated games. And Xbox One is going through all this work, and a lot of this stuff is being basically retrofitted to work on the Xbox One for totally free, just to kind of appease the gamers. Mm-hmm. And as an Xbox One owner, to me, that's a really good thing. It really makes my Xbox...
So there's things that first place doesn't have to do, right? You know, like, when you're second place, you're hungry. You want to get in there. You know, we saw it last generation. PlayStation 3 was in second place, and they were hungry. By the end of that generation, man, they were doing so much cool stuff, and they forced Microsoft to start doing it too. And now Microsoft's in that position, and I think they're in that same place Sony was in last generation, where, you know, sure, we'll start giving away free games, see what happens here. We'll start, you know, we'll do this, we'll do that. And now, you know, it's just the roles have switched, but they're hungry. They're hungry.
Especially the competition. Like, it just benefits the consumer endlessly because they try the best to create better products and they want to outdo each other. And this really benefits the consumer and benefits everybody. Yeah. Like, I think competition is good in every way.
I think if the rumors of this Xbox Next are true, what Microsoft is doing right now is going to really benefit them in the long run. If they do announce at E3 this year that they're working on a new Xbox, which is not an Xbox 1.5, it's actually their new console, and they're going to release it a little bit early, and it's going to trump everything that the PlayStation 4K can do, I think it's going to bode really well for them. I think they're trying to introduce these slightly shorter console life cycles, 3 to 4 years. And if it works, why not? You know, I mean, if they're going to start releasing a new console every 4 years, the consumers are just going to start becoming more prepared for that, and we're going to be looking forward to new technology.
Are they
going to
become more prepared for that, or is that going to send them over to the PC?
I'll never go to PC. I just personally, I can't speak for everybody else. I can't.
Yeah.
But personally, I'll never go to that dark place. I'm a console gamer, and that's just the way I feel. But if it's a 4-year life cycle, 5-year life cycle, a lot of gamers who have an issue with it pretty soon won't. You know, over the course of a 2 or 3 console generations, it's going to become the norm, and maybe it'll cause these companies to release consoles at a slightly less retail price when they're first announced. Who knows, man? The future's bright. I think the future's bright, and I think Microsoft is going to, release a new console in 2017, their plans with the Xbox One backwards compatibility and all the things they're doing to make the Xbox One more reasonable and attractive to the consumer is going to also transcend and go over to the new console.
I mean, this is going to be interesting to watch out. Like, I think PlayStation Neo almost 100% is going to be at E3. It just seems like this thing is real. It is definitely going to be happening. And it's going to be up by the end of the year. The upgraded Xbox, I don't know if that's as likely, but I could see that as a possibility too.
I think they may mention something possibly. More than likely, you're right. More than likely, they won't.
They won't mention shit if that thing's not coming out this year.
No.
Oh, definitely. It's definitely not coming out this year. No.
Yeah. It'd be silly because they're just going to stop Xbox One sales. Once they announce that thing's official, that thing's going to hit. You know that. Once they do that announcement, right, it's not just gamers that are talking about it. It's not just the people who read gaming websites who know about it and who will hold off on purchases. It'll go up on CNN. CNN will have a news story about it. You know, like MSNBC will have a news story about it. You know, like it'll hit like mass media. And then mom's not buying it for their kids. You know, like the mass market will stop buying these things. And that would be just bad news for Microsoft. Like real bad news.
Absolutely.
So they won't announce it. Well, I don't think they will.
The thing is, right, we know pretty much there's a nice group of games that are going to be talked about and released this year on PlayStation and on Xbox. But the big news that came from Microsoft last year, the biggest news was their Xbox One backwards compatibility. That was the one thing that people talked about the most. It was the thing that resonated with the gamers more so than any of the games that they touted releasing. And so, with that in mind, I'm thinking that they may try something like that once again, because it really shined a spotlight on the Xbox One, and it made them look like they were more consumer friendly and more for the gamer than the PlayStation at that time. And right now, you know, especially when it comes to exclusives with Uncharted just now releasing, I think they need to do something else, you know, that makes the Xbox One more accessible and enjoyable for the gamer. I just don't know what it would be, whether it be other forms of emulation, like the original Xbox. They said it's not impossible. I wonder, you know, what if they were to do something like that this year and say we're announcing the original Xbox backwards compatibility and we already got 500 or 300 or 400 games ready to go right now. That would just make people flip their shit, especially older gamers who kind of hone their skills playing things like Blinks the Cat.
What? I don't know what that game is.
It's before your time, son. It's way back in those days, you know? You know, right. Blinks the Cat was one of the first original Xbox games, and it totally sucks, so please just forget that name. But there's a lobby of people who actually want to buy the rights of that and relaunch a new Blinks the Cat. He was a time-sweeping cat. He could go through time and fast-forward time and stop it and rewind it. He was a fucking cat.
Yeah.
He had green eyes. It scared the shit out of me. It looked like something from a Tim Burton movie. But hey, the game still sucked. All right, okay. GTA 5 has now sold over 65 million copies in its lifetime.
Printing that money, bitches. Pretty much how Rockstar's feeling right now. Like, that's nuts. That's incredible.
65 million copies. Shit. That's insane. Only GTA 5 is the only game that sells like fucking Minecraft. It sells like Minecraft. It doesn't stop selling.
It keeps going, yeah.
I mean, there's tons of great games out there. Halo, you know, Ori and the Blind Forest, Mario. These games don't consistently sell for fucking years. When did GTA 5 come out? 2013?
2013, September, yeah.
So it's been selling like this for, they're still talking about it 3 years later, and they've hit 65 million sales.
The thing is, though, is you make the comparison to Minecraft, and there's other similarities to draw there. You know, it's a sandbox game. It's open to do a lot of different things. You can play it with your friends. You know, you can, I don't know, are there mods on PC yet for, I bet there are,
GTA.
Right?
For GTA, yeah. There's tons.
Yeah, but,
there's
like, tons. Yeah, you got multiplayer. I mean, there's just so much you can do with it. You know, they're still adding to the game, as far as I know. Are they still adding heists to that game?
I think heists.
There's a new update coming. So there you go. I mean, they're supporting it. They're you know, like, there's just a lot to that game. It's got a plenty of support on YouTube and on Twitch. People play it there. You can see, like, all this ridiculous stuff that people are doing. You want to go replicate with that with your friends. It's just so wide open that, I don't know, it's just a lot of fun.
I mean, the thing is, they've really, for lack of a better term, they've created a real world. It's just so much that you can do in this game, and so many places you can go, so many things you can do, so many side things you can do and partake in, you know, games, hunting, all this kind of crap that really exists in the real world. They haven't released any single-player DLC for this game.
No.
You know, and there's still enough meat on this single package 3 years later that people are still buying it like crazy. I just bought the game for Brandon, my son, a couple days ago. His birthday was the 14th. He turned 14, looked real snazzy, went out to his 8th grade prom and shit. But I bought him that game, and he went just ape shit on it. He has it on PS3, but he wanted it on PS4, so I got him. He's just been going nonstop. And I'm like, wow, you've had this game all these years on PS3, and I ask you what game you want on PS4? And there's games out like Battleborn. All this stuff is out and available. Uncharted's available. What game do you want, son? Well, Dad, I'd really appreciate it if you got me GTA 5.
Yeah, but is he going on there and playing with his friends? Like, who's to judge? Like, my kids have been playing Minecraft for 5 years. It's like they've been playing with their friends. They all get together. They could build stuff. They could play mini games. You know, they play CS:GO. They play CS:GO, like a mod of CS:GO in Minecraft.
Minecraft.
And they get to keep all those servers. Each server has different mods on it. Like, it's become its own little gaming community. There's plenty of stuff to do.
It's not even a game.
It really is a platform. And, you know, like, I didn't get it at first, but the more I've watched my kids doing it, like, the more I really understand it. Yes, this is more than just one video game. This is a platform. This is, and just having all your friends be able to do, like, you know, sure, you're keeping that, like, same graphical set. Well, not even that, because you can mod that out. But you're moving in these worlds that you immediately understand the basis of movement. You understand, like, the basis of physics. But the games just keep changing over time because people are constantly modding these new games. Like, it's really cool.
Yeah, speaking of that, my older son, I caught him. I walked in his room. No, I didn't catch him playing with himself. I caught him playing Minecraft.
That's where that was going.
Yeah. I was like, what's going on? He's like, oh, I'm just playing Minecraft, Daddy. And I'm thinking, wow, you're in high school. You're going to 10th grade next year, and you're playing Minecraft. To me, it's amazing. I have nothing bad to say about it because I'm almost 40, and I, from time to time, play Minecraft.
Fuck, that's old.
Yeah. Old enough to be your dad, son. You better remember that shit. All right, and so continuing on, Robbie just said, damn, he's right. All right, so continuing on, Destiny Rise of the Iron expansion has been leaked. An announcement that next month's E3 is very, very likely. We talked about this very briefly earlier in the show. You think they're going to announce this at
E3? 100%. Yeah, I could definitely see that. Didn't they say this earlier this year before the April update came out, there would be an expansion? I'm pretty sure they did for this fall, so.
Yeah, we know there's going to be an expansion this fall. We expected to see it at E3. The thing here is just the promotional material. It's so interesting that it's the Rise of Iron, right? Which is, and we got Lord Saladin, who's associated with Iron Banner, which is associated with PvP.
Yep.
We also think, based on Kotaku leaks, that it's going to be a Fallen-based raid, which is very interesting. We haven't had one of those before. There's more to explore about the Fallen. Interesting thing about the Fallen to me are they're the race most similar to humans, so that, you know, it'd be fun to explore their culture and do a raid. I don't know what that raid's going to be, whether it's going to be them attacking us on Earth or if we're going to go to one of their catches and go into their spaceship and raid a spaceship. Who knows what it's going to be, but I'm really looking forward to it.
Well, you know, it kind of makes me sad, right? Because the things that we don't like to admit as gamers are that some games have a tether on you, yeah. and you might step, like Robbie, you'll understand totally what I'm saying. Just let me finish. Some games you can step away from for months. I haven't played Destiny in a very long time. But every time a new expansion comes out, I drop whatever I'm doing. I could be changing a diaper. Just, oh, drop the baby. Boom.
Back to Destiny.
Straight to Destiny.
Because don't do I that, though. That's bad parenting.
Yeah, well.
Who are you to kid. Judge?
I'm kid, so I say that's fucking bad parenting.
It was my right? kid, all right?
Maybe that kid, you don't know what happened up to that point. Maybe that kid deserved to be dropped.
Listen, to be honest, Robbie, the baby Jesus. Was a squirter, okay?
The baby was a squirter.
I'm not going to say squirting from where, but I just couldn't deal with it anymore.
It doesn't matter.
I'll turn off my camera.
That baby started squirting. You dropped that baby.
Oh, no. Oh, no.
See the mother jump.
You might have a nice new shirt on. You don't want to get that shit all over your shirt, you know?
Right. Down for
imagine,
this.
Imagine how Vader would look with a green smear on top of his right. helmet.
That baby's got to learn to hold it.
And know when to hold it, know when to fold it.
Inopportune time.
This is the best show ever, right? But what I'm saying is, back to what I was saying, Destiny just has that kind of hold on me, right? And it's I'm really enjoying right now just going through games I've never played before. I've kind of stepped away. I stepped away from The Last of Us, Briar. Robbie. But I've actually started playing other shit. And it really feels good. But I know that once this expansion comes out, I'm going to go right back to Destiny because it has something magical about it.
Yeah.
When you know when you're used to it and you go in there and you walk through a door that you knew was there before, but you could not access it, then you walk in there and there's a whole new world. There's something special about that. When you see new weapons and new enemies introduced, there's something special about going to something that you're familiar with and seeing it change. So that's the one thing I can say about Destiny. It may not be the game that I play all year long, but whenever they do announce or release a new expansion, it's got me for a few weeks at least. Me too. Every time. So, I mean, when a game is as powerful as Destiny, you know, a game that has the kind of rapport with the gamer that the Destiny has, they can always count on those expansions selling like gangbusters because people have already invested tons of money into the game. You know, it's a game I haven't played in a long time, but I've invested well over $100 into it. You know, it's not like same a here. $60 investment. And so now, you know, every time a new expansion comes out, the game just seems more top tier to me, you know. Briar, I know you probably spent $300 on it at least, you know, at this point.
I can't even calculate. Somebody asked that question on the Planet Destiny podcast this week. We do like Twitter questions at the end. Somebody asked, and I couldn't even figure it out how much I spent. Wow. I bought multiple copies for multiple consoles.
Think I've spent $300 total on Destiny because I bought the game on both PS4 and Xbox One with the Taken King and with the two expansions. That would be about $280.
Mm-hmm.
I think I've spent a little more than that on the silver as well. So, yeah, $300. That's a lot.
Hardcore, man.
But, I mean,
you can do a lot.
I also looked at how many hours I've played it for, and it was like 1,600 hours.
Wow. Yeah. I mean, I've still played it for a lot, too. I haven't played it in months, but I can't even imagine how much time I put into that game. Yeah. Well,
you know, once the Destiny saga finally comes to an end and there are definitive credits that roll at the end of Destiny 1 story, they should put in a special thanks to you, Briar, because you've made this game.
I think so, too. I totally agree. In fact,
you contributed so much of your life to the game.
I'm a little bit taken aback, excuse the wording there, that they haven't already done so, you know?
I
feel like it's not just time to acknowledge my contributions. I feel like it's overdue.
Damn right. You've turned on so many aimless children to the game. Children just wandering the voidless world.
I mean, frankly, Bungie owes all their success again to me.
Yeah.
And not just Bungie. Not just Bungie. I would say Sony, Microsoft, possibly the world at large. I mean, I'm really keeping it together out here.
Hold it together. Hold it together.
I'm holding it down up in here. But who's keeping track? I'm, you know.
Somebody is, damn it. I obviously somebody is. All right, so what are you guys going to be playing this week? Now, I know Overwatch comes out tomorrow.
It's Overwatch, man. I am so stoked for that game.
Just say it's over. It's over.
It's over.
It's over.
In fact, as soon as we get off stream today, I'm going to make sure that my pre-order is all set so that I can preload the game, because I think you can preload the game like starting like right now.
Damn.
On PS4, and I am so stoked for it.
See, this is my dilemma, right? I want to get Battleborn because I did enjoy Battleborn.
Mm-hmm.
I want to play that. Yeah, I think I'll be done with Doom tonight. No later than tomorrow, I'll be completely done with that. I want to do a quick review on Doom. And so now Overwatch is out. It's a game I like more than Battleborn, but Battleborn still exists. So it's like in the back of my mind, I want to get Battleborn first, but probably will end up getting Overwatch.
Yeah.
Robbie, what about you?
Well, I just spent a lot of my first paycheck from work on a brand new SCUF controller, so I don't know if I'll be getting it, but I might get it in a couple weeks. Like, I'm still not even sure if I'm going to buy it right away, so I mean, we'll see. Maybe when I get paid next.
Did you play the beta?
Possible. Yes, loved the beta. It was really fun. But again, I'm not sure if it's a $60 game, you know? That's kind of my thing with it. I'm not sure if it's
That's worth fair, it man. But it's, I really enjoyed it. It's a multiplayer-only game. There is no single player.
Awesome game. Like, I fair. Loved it. But that's totally again, fair. It's just the price is a little, yeah, not sure.
I would have loved if they had, like, a single-player campaign in there. Because, like, those characters, to me, they're just so compelling. They're so much.
Absolutely.
They're just fun to look at and to listen to. And I would love to see even a short campaign, like, with each character, you know, just a little something.
Yep.
But like, if you go and watch their trailers, like they have these little like
they're 3 minute Pixar trailers. Quality.
Oh, they're amazing! Pixar they're amazing.
Pixar quality. The best $60 I spent on a game lately was from this game here, the Uncharted 4.
That's a very nice style there.
Yes, and he watches me while collect I sleep. Dolls,
confirmed.
Yeah. Yeah, it's cool now. You know, back in the day, being a nerd or a dweeb or a gamer was just whack. It was lame. Get the fuck out of here.
Yeah, fuck it off.
Now, if you're all three in tandem, you can run for president.
Yeah, we all we really owe it to the movie Revenge of the Nerds, where obviously there was a revenge for the nerds. Now, as we can see, we are running the world.
Did you? Absolutely right. First of all, say I can't wait to play Doom. But secondly, I wanted to thank some of my subscribers and some of my friends out there by name. I wanted to say a shout out to Dwayne, shout out to Mike, a shout out to Donnell, some of my subscribers, to everybody, Miss K, who watches the show religiously every week.
Miss K?
Thank you all. Yes.
Oh, damn.
It stands for Kellogg's. No, Miss K is a special K. She's a special K. Miss K is actually a YouTuber, and she's a great friend and a very positive influence in the YouTubing community. She's all about gaming, and she watches the Beastly Thoughts show every week. She comes to your channel and leaves comments. She comes to mine and leaves comments. And to everybody who I mentioned, thank you all so much for continuing to listen to us bullshit for an hour every week. It's a great time for me. You know, I'm out there talking about real life with my wife and kids, and then, you know, I just get filled with bullshit throughout the week, and it has to come out sometime.
This is like a shit explosion right here on the internet.
This podcast is just a shit explosion.
You better be careful. Yeah. Somebody's going to drop your ass on the floor.
You better be careful.
Yeah, man, doing this show every week is super fun. We are exploring getting a fourth host. I'm not sure what direction that's going to take right now. We've talked about having somebody who isn't necessarily on YouTube. We've also talked about having somebody who's, you know, I don't know, man. I don't know what direction that's going to take. We're definitely exploring it. We'd love to kind of just add a fourth viewpoint into the show on a regular basis.
Like someone that works.
Well, we like to probably vet someone out there. Who at least has the passion for gaming that we do.
Yeah.
I think somebody
who likes to get naked a lot. You know, I can go either way on that.
Yeah, well, absolutely. I don't know shit about games, but hey, here are my boobs. Oh, yeah. I mean, to me, that works fine. Oh. Ass shots are even better.
Who doesn't like that?
Robbie?
Look, all right. I'm saying is I like nudity. Yeah. I mean, whether it's me doing it or you doing it, like, somebody's doing it, and I'm happy.
One day we're going to invite you guys to the pre-show, the warm-up, the first 45 minutes warm-up, and we always get dressed 2 minutes before we go live. Mm-hmm. It's always nude.
They say, you know, imagine your audience naked. Well, I can't do that unless I'm naked. Otherwise, I just feel uncomfortable.
Damn right. I feel totally overdressed. Off, Let me take this off.
Imagine everyone else is naked out in public. You'll be good to go. Right. It'll be a good day.
Yeah. I mean, also, you're probably going to have a lot of fun that day.
Yeah.
Everyone will get naked with you.
Yeah.
It's a good time.
I recommend staying away from Arby's, though. You don't want to go there seeing everybody horse naked. Horseradish. Go stay away from
horseradish there.
It's bad news over up in there.
That's a roast beef, you know. You don't want that roast beef. Oh,
too far, Robbie. Too far.
Damn, Robbie. You've been on Pornhub today, haven't you?
Oh, my God.
Come on, Robbie. If it's shaved, it's all right.
Let's end this damn podcast. Oh, my God.
All right. Thank you guys so much for hanging out. We'll be back next week, 10 minutes late, as usual. You know what I'm going to do for the pre-show is just let everybody hear me swear at OBS for 10 minutes.
That's pretty much what it was today. You were absolutely like, come on, OBS.
Come on, you can do it, OBS.
You can do it.
It was like a pep talk from a coach who didn't believe in the person he was coaching. And then once the person lost, the coach just lost it on them. Yeah. It's like, you can do it. And then all of a sudden, you fucking suck. I can't fucking believe
you're the
you.
Worst. You're the worst. You can't even bench warm properly. You can't even bring us towels right.
Yeah, that's exactly what it was like, guys. One day I'm going to record that and just put it up on the channel.
Oh, man.
It starts off so well, you know? Everyone's peaceful and talking. You hear Brian, okay, here we go. And then, fuck! And then all
of a sudden, brilliant idea.
What I got to do is I gotta bite the bullet and switch software and just get away from OBS because I think I'm just fighting an uphill battle with this software.
I mean, I think
it's like
OBS,
I spent so much time configuring it and getting it ready, like I don't want to lose all that progress and move over to XSplit.
Well, I think that the company, I don't know what the name of the company is that made OBS, but I think they're just trolling everybody because of the last two letters of the name. I mean, everybody should know it's a lot of bullshit if BS is in the name. OBS. Come on.
You make a strong point there.
I think it's just the world's biggest troll. They're trolling everybody.
Yeah, they're putting it right out on the internet.
Yeah. Straight up bullshit.
And no one even... And just all bite the bullet.
What he said.
And I just got an awesome idea, though. What if we did like a video outtake of all the funny moments of the podcast, like all the different episodes? We should do that.
I like it.
Just thought of that.
I think you should do it too, man. I think that'd be awesome.
I think right now it'd be a great moment to put in that little anthology of clips right now. I think it'd be great.
All right, guys. Thank you very much for watching. We'll see you next week.
Bye, everybody.
See you guys.
Woo!
Until next time. Play Uncharted and play Doom.
Channel. All right, we can get naked again.